ed experts warn about lowering standards during crisis, proving once and for all that higher ed experts cannot tell when horses have already left barns and when ships have sailed. I'm Dr. Duke, she's Katie, and this is the Dr. Duke Show. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Dr. Duke Show, the only program that keeps you educated on the craziness impacting K-12 classrooms and college campuses worldwide. Today, we discuss an English professor who has decided to award A's to all of her students, just as Arizona students demand they stop classes and receive passing grades, and all while Penn State students are being allowed to change their own final grades after they're submitted. Plus, we deliver some real education with Percy Shelley's instant classic poem, Ozymandias. But we start on the college campus, where experts warn about the ramifications of lowering class standards and writing off the academic year due to the coronavirus. And before we get into the story, you'll tell us the details. I gotta tell you, Mom and Dad, that ship has sailed. That barn door is already open. We have been lowering standards for about 10 years now. Why? Because we've lowered standards for public school education. We've transformed K-12 education into an exercise of inclusion and social justice, not high levels of accomplishment. So what's happened? We've dumbed down education in the public schools. We've therefore had to lower the standards for college admission. Coronavirus is just going to accelerate this, just like our money woes. Right, are going to be our debt is going to be radically accelerated. We were well on the way to much more debt anyway. Same thing here. If you think coronavirus is the excuse why we're dumbing down our college classes, you just have been absent from class for far too long.
The expert we're taking a look at today is coming out of from the campus reform. They recently talked to an education expert, Jonathan Pidluzny, who's the director of academic affairs at the American Council of Trustees and Alumni, ACTA. And they talked to him about the effects of these grading changes that are happening, as you said, by the coronavirus. And take a look at what he has to say about it.
The real danger, I think, is to moving into a sort of uniform pass-fail system where faculty are simply asked to grade on a pass-fail basis, because I think, you know, it's easier for faculty, it's also easier for the students. And when you make things easier, you take away one of the strongest incentives to learn. But what I always told my students was that, you know, preparing for class is like going to the gym. It's not enough to show up. You actually have to do the work. And it's the work that translates into things like cognitive gain and mastery of content. Cognitive gain and mastery of content are the real purposes of that collegiate education. And so if we take away the incentives, I think both on the faculty side and the student side, people are going to be working a little bit less hard. And working a little bit less hard, I think, will translate into worse outcomes.
And while he is drier than unbuttered toast, he makes a couple of useful points. Again, that should be obvious. If you're giving kids grades for the purpose of social promotion, that's what this is. Virus or no virus, you are socially promoting kids. I talked about this last week on the show. We've created a system now where we should be asking our kids to not be paralyzed. Kids, we're talking 19, 20, 21, 22-year-olds. They're adults. We're asking adult college kids now, rather than to double down on their work ethic, to use this time of crisis to push their own learning harder and farther, to expect more from kids in time of crisis, we're asking less. The idea is that, there's a horrible thing going on that won't end up affecting most of us, and certainly won't have really severe consequences for the youngest of us. So that means we all have to stop what we're doing. What happened to the America where when you hit a crisis or a depression, where you had a war, or you had some catastrophe, a terrorist attack, or you had a virus, where everybody rolled up their sleeves and decided we were going to work three times as hard, not stop working because, you know, we're so anxious, we're so nervous. What kind of a world are we living in here?
And that's exactly what he says as well. Pidluzny says what universities really wanted to do was just lower the anxiety level a little bit for students. And so I think what they have to be conscious of in lowering the anxiety level, they don't destroy important incentives. But what they're doing clearly is focusing on the social-emotional learning, right, as we've always been discussing on this show, compared to the actual education that they are supposed to be receiving.
And they are not lowering standards a little bit. If you're telling kids you're going to get A's for showing up, if you tell kids that no matter what grade the teacher assigns you, you can ungrade it, change it afterwards, these are not small concessions. And I got news for you. Did you see pictures of those idiot Florida kids all over the country in Florida dancing on the beaches? They don't. Their anxiety is bull. If there's one group in this country who has been trained to never feel bad about anything and to never think of anybody but themselves, it would be modern college kids. All the anxiety is made up anxiety on the parts of the professors. These kids don't care.
Well, and as we learned from AOC, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, you can't actually pick yourself up by your bootstraps. That's somehow racist. So this is what they've been taught is, oh, I'm not going to pick myself up by my bootstraps. I physically can't do it. So I'm just going to be on the beach, drink till I pass out, get a really, really bad burn, and then start over.
Well, and for how many of those kids, whether we're talking public school, high school kids, we're talking about university, stop calling them kids, adult college students, how many of them are going to take their studies less seriously now that it's unaccountably on video learning? I guarantee you that 9 out of 10 of these kids are going to learn less even than they have to, because it's easier to slide when you're doing these distance videos. What the professor says there makes sense, but I think he undersells it. Why, look, and if you can do this, if you can do this because of the coronavirus, then anything that provides kids anxiety, you have to account for. Grades are anxiety causing. Letting some colleges decide that will take some kids and not others. Boy, I've got a 1.8 GPA, all right, and I've got a federal rap sheet for beating up three of my teachers, but I've applied to your school, and the fact that you're making me wait for an answer, not just accepting me, causes anxiety. How many aspects of schooling, serious learning now, quizzes, exams, expectations, asking them to read whole books, right? Ooh. How much of what we do as educators is predicated on what they now describe as anxiety-driven?
All of it. Well, I think Oprah said it best. You get an A, you get an A, and you also get an A. We have a story coming out of Concordia University in Texas, where Joe McIntosh, the English instructor, oh, your favorite English instructors, announced to her students, she wrote, if you're working on your coursework, stop. I am entering A's for every student. There's more than a month left in the semester, but you know what McIntosh told her students? I made this decision after reviewing each student's ability to meet the course objectives based on the work you've turned in up to this point, and see that each of you has achieved those objectives at some point, or I can assess that you could have achieved those objectives had we stayed on campus this semester.
So before we even start this, you quoted Oprah. The only thing Oprah has ever said correctly was, Stedman, get me a sandwich, all right? Let me just put that on the table right now. Having said that, do you see what this professor's doing? She has decided in her own mind, without even having to test them anymore or give them any more assignments, she's decided what they're capable of. And even if you haven't achieved it yet, I can determine that you would have. You all would have gotten there, right? So I'm just going to go ahead and give you A's now. How do you undo this when the semester's over? Exactly. On the basis of what? If she can decide after, maybe we should have, instead of semesters, instead of quarters, maybe we should have 1/8. What would that be called? 80s?
Eighties?
Semesters, quarters. Maybe we should have eighties, right? Where you go to a class for an eighth of a semester, and the teacher will just decide on a couple of weeks' work what you would have done at the end and given you a grade.
Absolutely.
It's absolutely ridiculous. And it's all of this faux compassion, this fake, made up, manufactured, for anxious kids who aren't anxious, too self-centered. We've raised them too narcissistically and so self-centeredly to be really anxious for other people. This is all the professor's projection, right?
Oh yeah.
And it's all about, and isn't it coincident that the professor's projection and her inability to have to work anymore coincide here?
Interesting. McIntosh also said that she, quote, may be in touch with her students about joining honors organizations or to share a video or a link that they would have looked at together, but that as far as this official coursework, there will be
no
further assignments needed
for
this course.
I have not evaluated you. I have not asked you to complete the semester. I'm not going to hold you accountable at all for your grade. I'll give you an A. And I want you to apply for honors programs, right?
Yep.
And why? Because if you're turned down, that's anxiety creating, right? All you kids who didn't have to do any work, now that I've given you fake A's, I want you to storm the barricades of remaining honors colleges and demand to be let in, right? Because an honors diploma is now just a social construct like a college diploma is. It doesn't mean what you think it means.
And I know you said pretty much 9 out of 10 college students would not put any put forth any work. Well, freshman Kayla Reed is in that class, and she's actually frustrated because she had a 99% to this point, which that's telling of it.
Yes.
If you get a 99% in any college course, how difficult
one has to ask the question. Yeah. Right?
But anyway, she said that there are people who never showed up and that they did peer review work within the class. Those who did it was low caliber. She said she clarified she would not say that everyone would have received an A and that they learned what they would have learned in the semester or in the classroom for the whole semester. Kayla is very upset and is like, are you kidding me?
This is the scarring socialist reality of this kind of grading, right? If everybody gets an A, whether they try or not, then real A's don't matter anymore. This is, again, this is a complete product of socialist mindsets in universities. It shows you how far down the socialist rabbit hole a lot of these professors have gone. And again, it's not new to coronavirus. Coronavirus is not advancing this. It is simply exposing it to much greater scrutiny and giving college professors an opportunity to indulge their socialism in ways they wouldn't have been able to do 2 months ago. But 2 months from now, when this is all over, how again do you roll back this clock? I don't think that you can.
And if it's not the whole they all get A's, at least they all should get passing grades. And that's what's happening with thousands of University of Arizona students who have signed a petition saying they need to end the spring semester right now because of COVID-19, but they should also all get issued passing grades at the end. Maritza Almanza is a sophomore studying psychology, and she started a change.org petition to end the spring classes at the university and to adopt a pass-fail grading system. She, the last time I looked, had 9,000 signatures saying, you know what, yeah, we should do this. The specific petition said, the coronavirus outbreak is impairing students at the University of Arizona from completing and passing their classes. The university had a seemingly humane response in which all classes, including in-person classes, are going to be online for the rest of the semester. This is not an effective solution in the time of crisis.
Right. Giving us passing. And if you're the poor little overachiever in the previous story who had 99%, like, now you get a pass, right?
Thanks.
And how soon before, it's already moving, how soon before universities move to a pass-fail system? The professor we saw in the first story talked about this, right? Be careful about this, because if you're moving to a pass-fail situation, it is no longer a college education, right?
And all of this, when we talk about the anxiety and their reasoning with the anxiety, this Almanza who created the petition, the reasoning for why we should go to this pass-fail is because although online classes help slow the spread of the virus, they still require intellectual and sometimes emotional labor. This labor should not be the focus of students right now. They should be self-isolating and focusing on their health so they don't get the virus. It's unreasonable to expect students to still be productive in a time of crisis. This is expecting too much from U of A students.
Besides how witheringly childish that is, notice the logical gaps, right? That we're going to be separating and isolating. We're going to lock ourselves away from everybody, and we're going to work on our health. Explain to me what you can do to avoid the coronavirus besides isolating yourself. So now that you've isolated yourself, little snowflake, what do you do 23 hours and 59 seconds for the rest of your day?
Well, right? it's unreasonable to expect students to still be productive in a time of crisis, but what about our nurses, our doctors, our first responders, the adults need to be, but us, college.
We're lecturing the adults, and who bred these little Frankensteins, monsters? Who did this? This is the work of university professors. And by the way, if you go to a program in schools, in colleges, then an A becomes a pass. Think about that for a second. If you get rid of A, B, C, D's, and F, if you stop actually evaluating kids and you go pass or fail, then guess what? A pass isn't just a pass anymore. It's not a 60%, right? D minus. A pass is now an A because it could include everything from 100% down to 60%. So what you've done is you've reduced real grades to A or not A.
And I just want to read the next one because she has three reasons total because I know it'll get you all worked up. Number two, as mentioned, it's unreasonable for the university to still expect productivity from its students when the virus is causing immense stress. The option of a pass-fail system will honor the work that students have already done in their classes and remove the stressors that could endanger them more to the virus. Students should be planning how to survive the virus and quarantine themselves, not how they're going to pass their classes.
Again, we need to spend all our time quarantining ourselves. As this is literally the level at which the little snowflakes operate. A full time. How soon before they start arguing, we should get basic monthly income.
Universal basic income, UBI, here it is.
If I'm spending all my time every day, all day isolating myself, if quarantining myself is a 24/7 full-time job, don't you have to pay me for my labor?
Well, yes. Should I read the third one?
Yeah, go ahead.
Fine, I'll read the third and final. We also demand a partial reimbursement of tuition for every student. The assumption of paying tuition is trust in the university's ability to accommodate the needs of students. The coronavirus outbreak is making that increasingly difficult as more cases are confirmed in Tucson. They're in Arizona
Logic.
Again. The university cannot live up to the responsibilities it promised its students. If the university truly values the safety and lives of its students, there should be no problem agreeing to reimburse students. People are always more important than profits.
So she just got through. The university is trying to logically honor its commitment by giving you online education.
Yep.
You just said no, because it hurts when you do that to me. And then she has the gall to come back and say, and pay me for what you're not able to do.
You know that meme of Kermit just sitting there?
Yeah, there. That's it. That's the Kermit meme right there. I'm telling you, don't educate me anymore. Oh, and by the way, because you're not educating me anymore after I told you not to, pay me. Welcome, my friends, to the future when millennials control everything.
And if you do get a grade and you say, you know what, I don't like that grade, at Penn State, they are allowing students.
We are. Change our own grades.
That just doesn't have the same ring to it. Penn State is allowing students to change to a non-traditional grading scale after getting their final grades. So students who get Fs, an F for fail, will have the option of choosing a weightless Z.
Oh my God, now we're gendering the alphabetical number letters.
When I read that.
Oh, Jesus. Are you seriously?
Go ahead. According to university announcement on the coronavirus FAQ page, they wrote, at the end of the spring semester, once students receive their letter grades, they will have the option on a course-by-course basis for those grades to remain as letter grades or to appear as one of three options on a new unsatisfactory grading scale.
You know how in those stupid Penn State football games, every time they get a first down, there's a...
No, because I don't watch Penn State.
The lion roars.
Wisconsin.
The lion roars.
No, does it?
Oh, right?
Then
after every stupid first down, every time... I want you to read that last suggestion again. I'm going to give a roar, a Penn State roar, after every clause.
At the end of the spring semester... Once students receive their letter grades, they will have the option, on a course-by-course basis, for those grades to remain as letter grades or to appear as one of three options on a new satisfactory-unsatisfactory grading scale.
We are Penn State. Way to lead the Big Ten in stupidity, although I'm sure this won't be the last of it. How many stories have we done about UW-Madison? But today,
yeah,
I think
fun.
The reigning buffoonery out of the Big Ten is all yours, Penn State.
In case anyone was wondering about the three grades. Grades of C or better can be changed to a grade of SAT. For satisfactory, a D, as in dog, can be changed to a V. I don't know if it's supposed to be for victory. Or a failing grade can become a Z. So a Z means no grade designation, and a V means pass.
So basically Z means it never happened.
Yeah.
So instead of a F, you get a Z, which means that never happened. Okay. I think I like Penn State better. During the Sandusky years.
Oh, that's...
No, he didn't.
No, he didn't. You know what? And now time for some real education.
All silliness aside, this is a time for us to engage, to commit an actual act of education. This is We Are Instant Classics.
All right. Well, with that introduction, we're going to take a look at Percy Shelley, who is one of those romantic poets back from the early 19th century, writing the beautiful lyrical and philosophical poems. This may be, I think, how he got his second wife, who is known as Mary Shelley. You may have heard of her. She wrote the novel Frankenstein. Well, anyway, one of Percy's most famous poems is Ozymandias. It was published in 1818, 4 years before his death. The poem is a sonnet, and it was written because it was a competition, actually, between him and a friend. They were given the same topic and the same title, and they had to write what they could. And Ozymandias, I found out, is a Greek name for Ramses II, who was an Egyptian pharaoh. So I thought that was kind of interesting.
Yeah, Ozymandias is a really interesting poem. It's a sonnet, as you said, by a romantic poet, Percy Bysshe Shelley. And it's an ubi sunt poem.
What?
Ubi sunt means where have they gone, colloquially, right? Where have all the great men gone? Where have you gone, Joe DiMaggio? Is an ubi sunt phrase from the Mrs. Robinson song. An ubi sunt themed poem is a poem that looks at the pretensions of mankind, of humanity, the great boasts of heroes and conquerors past, and what's become of them in all the time since, right? And so the story is about a wanderer in the desert who comes across a pair of huge legs and feet in the middle of all this desert sand. What was once a thriving capital of a huge mega empire by Ramesses, right? Ozymandias, the great Egyptian pharaoh, has now all turned to dust. All that civilization is buried under tons and tons of sand. All that remains of the statue of Ozymandias, Ramesses II, all that remains is these two trunkless legs. And so it's a beautiful reflection on it's also a vanitas poem, the vanity of human pretension. It's like the book of Ecclesiastes, right? Vanity of vanity, saith the preacher, all is but vanity. All that we do under the sun, all of our pretension and our grandeur comes to naught. So take a look at the poem. I met a traveler from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them, on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage, a face, lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions red, which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things, the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. And on the pedestal of this broken statue, these words appear. My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, in despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. And so, thousands of years ago, in the middle of this arid desert, there was a thriving city, a metropolis, and there was this huge statue of Ramesses II, so big that its legs dwarf a human being. And now, and the boastfulness of human achievement carved onto the pedestal of that statue, my name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, in despair. And looking around, the traveler sees nothing but miles and miles of sterile sand. Right? This was the great King of Kings. This is all that's left.
My only addition is materialism, written to you in the early 19th century.
Yep. And it really, and also you should point out too, for those of you who are fans of Breaking Bad, that chilling piece of cinematic masterpiece, there's one of the last couple episodes of the entire series called Ozymandias. Ooh. If you think about Breaking Bad, Walter White builds this incredible criminal empire, right? Only to have it all fall to pieces at the end so that nothing is left, right? And so that's why the creators of Breaking Bad actually used one of the titles for the last few stories when it all crumbled under him, Ozymandias, that mighty empire that crumbled to dust.
And that's going to wrap it up for this Wednesday. For those of you with kids, just a reminder that Freedom Project Media is releasing 2 daily animated education videos on our Facebook page. We highlight a new American president every day at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time, and then one of the 56 signers of the Declaration of Independence at 2 p.m. So gather the kids, do a little homeschooling along with Freedom Project.
And on top of that, everything else we're doing for you to help you homeschool your kids is a daily instant classic like the one we just did on Ozymandias. And before we go, just a quick reminder, if you'd rather have your kids in a real school as opposed to the public schools that are now closed, if you'd rather have them in an environment that is Christian, that is classical in terms of education, that teaches your kids how to think, not what to think, then I want you to consider Freedom Project Academy. Our kids have not missed a day of class yet. We have live teachers teaching your kids over the internet in live, real-time classrooms. If you have a student in K through 12, take a look at our Judeo-Christian live online classes for next fall. This is the time. Enrollment is shrinking now. We're getting down to the point where classes are starting to fill. So get into this class. Request your free information packet at freedomforschool.com. That's freedomforschool.com. For Freedom Project, I'm Dr. Duke, and she's Katie. Until next time, stay educated, my friends.